you know, it's in the word. That's, to me, opinions are like noses. Everybody's got at least one. But I'm saying, it's not opinion, it's in scripture, and I'm going to minister to people who have fear of being cursed, and I don't believe in them. I've got no message for those people, for the majority of people in the world. And how many people are coming to this country? I mean, coming to Omaha from other countries? Huh? How many of them are struggling with the whole thing of being cursed from their culture? You better have an answer. Okay, I'll give you an answer. Remember, we have 101,800 and some downloads? Well, one of them is really excellent. It's breaking curses. It's a prayer. Now, I didn't know how to break curses. I mean, I knew, but how do you pray? If it's not your culture, it's like, I don't understand it hardly. But whoever wrote this is wonderful. I've used it all over the world and on all the reservations and seen marvelous things happen because you're praying specifically like you never prayed before. It's not a prayer as magic. You understand? I'm not saying this is a magic prayer. I'm saying this is a prayer that's worded to help you word your prayer to break curses because it's out of my culture. It's out of my world. And yet people live in fear of it. And I know there's people in this town that fear curses or have been cursed. And curses can go on and on. And even, I don't want to say the word. You know that cement thing that they build to hold water back? And they have turbos in them and everything? We're saying, when I say that to you, I curse you. How many parents, oh, you're going to amount to nothing. How come you can never? Do you understand? Those are what? They're literally putting a curse and a label on a kid. Why did I believe what I believe? It wasn't something that came up in my mind that I'm inferior. Or that I'm rejected, and it didn't come up. It's over a period of time. And we need to do a lot more blessing. I really do. I mean, we don't bless enough, I don't think. Okay, now this guy, coming from, people, if they're dabbling in all this, not dabbling, we're living in curses, living in all this stuff. His whole life, he started having horrible demonic problems. Horrible, unbelievable. Like, talk about weird stuff going on. So he would go to an occult place that dealt with the weirdness, and they would give him beads or oils or whatever, and when he'd leave, he was worse. So he's going to all these places, and it's getting worse. You know, every time he's going for help, it's like our counseling said that they leave worse. No, I hope not. But okay, now. He hears that the one last thing to do, the most powerful thing to get rid of his demonic powers, is to go to Trinidad and be baptized in goat's blood.
Oh.
So he goes to Trinidad and is baptized in goat's blood. And they've been giving him beads and all kinds of things to wear and all of that. And he was just at our office maybe 4 weeks ago. And after the goat's blood, he was worse. Instead of it doing whatever it's supposed to do, he kept getting darker, more down, more suicidal, all this stuff. And he was in the kitchen. And he had these rosaries. And the rosaries were certain colors because they represented certain saints that protect you. Different saints and so on. And he's in the kitchen with these rosaries around his neck. And he's in his 30s. And the rosaries break. Not pulled, not yanked, not anything. The beads are all over the floor. And he knew. Something's going on here. I mean, remember, he hadn't been to church. His family is occultic, and here his protective beads are all over the floor that led him to a Christian, that led him to Christ. And he's been a Christian for 3.5 years. And so I'm going to give you some ideas, so I don't want you to help me with them. Okay. Okay, the beads are broken, sorry. Okay. He is an avid reader of John Piper, Augustine, Spurgeon, Rabbi Zachariah, Andrew Murray, you name the godly people of the past, he's read them. Or is reading. He loves Spurgeon's sermons. This guy has a hunger that I've never seen. He can quote, he's 3 years, you know, 3 years out of the darkness, he can quote more scripture than I forgot. It's unbelievable. I mean, he's so hungry, you know, for the Lord and all of this. Okay. Well, we were sure we had to break, you know, the normal thing. Is there any curses or anything still there that maybe haven't been taken care of? We did all of that. He's gone back to the East Coast. And we're talking. And the Lord asked him, if you ask him if he wants to be discipled by you. I only have one slot left. And I have five guys awake. Just one opening. Besides the counseling, I mean, this is apart from that. And I just said, would you like me to disciple you? He said, I was praying you'd ask. I said, okay. I said, but like, it's going to be like Siamese twins. We're connected. Well, as I'm talking to him now that he's back home, and the books he's reading, the things he's learning, the scriptures he's learning, I've never seen any Christian where he is in 3 years. I saw the Bible school kids when they graduate aren't where he is, you know, with that just a heart and a hunger for God. He is super depressed. When I talk to him, I know him enough, and I love him enough, I can tell in the tone of his voice where he is. I don't care what he says. You know, he's been a Christian 3 years. He knows Christianese, so he knows, you know, what to say. But I can pick up that he's down, really down. Okay, now what's the one thing that is my birthright? As a believer, it's something that I use in my life all the time.
Holy Spirit.
What?
The Holy Spirit.
Yes, that's a birthright. This is something that Jesus said, I'm going to give you. My peace I give unto you. My peace I leave unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, or let it be afraid. When my peace is gone, immediately I ask God why. Now drive it down here at all. I was praying, and I noticed the angels were outside of the car. They were afraid. So, but, you know, I just, when my peace is gone, why? That's Jesus gave me. That's what he gives me. My birthright as a believer was to have what? Inner peace in all circumstances and in all situations. When it's not there, you ought to pray and say, God, why not? Where did I lose it, you know? Am I picking up? Am I going back to the worry thing? Am I going back to whatever? Okay, he has no inner peace. He has inner peace that he's saved. Okay, and James, you're out of this. He's too smart for his own britches. That's what my dad used to tell me. You're too smart for your own britches. Okay, what am I telling? Where do I go? Where do I start? But here's a guy that has such a deep, deep desire for God. What if he came to you?
Blessing to him and have him meditate.
I can't hear you. My hearing aid.
Blessing him and have him meditate on God's word.
Just God's word?
No, blessings.
Yes.
You want to give them some time to like talk around the tables a little bit, kind of hash it out, and then give you some responses?
No, I want him to do it cold.
Throw it out.
Yeah, we've got the phone call.
So speak up.
And you gotta say something. Where would you start? Where would we start with this? Because this is pretty heavy duty counsel. You know what I'm saying? It's not just somebody that, you know, burnt the toast or, you know, it's having a simple, just simply having an affair or something. Yeah, go ahead.
What has he been thinking about? Like, replay your thoughts from the morning.
Okay. I pretty much know as he shares his heart with me where he is and what's going on and all of that. I know that.
Are you going to tell us?
I'm waiting for you to. I mean, you guys aren't you guys counselors?
How about forgiveness?
That's good. You know that Neil Anderson and I got together and we found that every single counsel lead that we get, regardless of the issues, the one thing they all had in common was unforgiveness. Because what does Scripture say? In Corinthians, if I hold bad feelings for somebody, 2 Corinthians, I think 2 Corinthians 10, I give Satan an advantage. Well, if I'm giving Satan an advantage with unforgiveness, how good am I going to do? And what does Ephesians say? If I have bitterness in my heart and so on, I'm in big trouble. Ephesians 6. I grieve the Holy Spirit. So if I'm giving Satan an advantage and grieving the Holy Spirit, where am I as a Christian? And I don't care if you're the pastor's wife. If you're the pastor's wife, I know why you're depressed. Okay, go ahead. But you understand? So that definitely, and I'm, you know, because we always look for that. In fact, our second day, we spend the whole 3 hours of counseling on forgiveness. And have you guys read the, what's that book called? The best we've read on, I have a lot of books on forgiveness.
Total Forgiveness.
That's it. R.C. Campbell. That is the best book out there today on forgiveness. Excellent. Because he goes to areas that maybe you've never dealt with. Once you read the book, if I go there, oh yeah, right away the little file card pops up in my mind. Oh yeah. Okay. But that's a good one. But we had dealt with that. See, on our week-long counseling, it's not pride. We spend 3 hours on pride. And usually for men, that is when the breakthrough comes in counseling. It's on Wednesday when we deal with pride. And they watch Nancy DeMoss's video on brokenness. Now, I have to be careful because Nancy DeMoss is a girl. And some people have real struggles with the girl. But we tell about Nancy because at our conferences we used to have for counselors, we've had Nancy DeMoss come twice. And we got up and said, Nancy will not speak. She wouldn't even speak here because there's some men here without telling you that she was speaking under the direction of the leadership. You know, the board or the pastor or whatever, that she would speak under that. So she's not usurping authority. Remember, that's one of the things about a woman just taking authority. You know, she was asked to do this. So a lot of people handle it. And a woman, I'm going to listen to a woman. You're married, don't you listen to your wife? I'm going to listen to a single, well, she's not single anymore. I'm going to listen to a gal that's married. But that pride is a big one. It's a big one. Because what was Satan's sin? Adultery? Child molestation? No. Was pride. And what did he say? He said, basically, when he made a statement, God, you can run heaven, and you can run the earth, but you can't run me. The I wills, the last of the I wills in Isaiah. So it's really a key. And guys, it really opens our eyes. I'll tell you, the pride thing for men, we do a lot of counseling of men. All of a sudden, it's like, wow, they see it. How much of their life is around them. They're the center. But that's not it either. We dealt with the pride as well. I gave you some clues. I mean, when I wrote this, I wanted to, you know, literally give you some ideas of what maybe it could be, because I missed it. Totally missed it. Until the last time I counseled him back last week, and it was broken.
So did you say that you've already dealt with the curses from your grandmother?
Yes, when he was there for counseling, just to be sure that that was dealt with, because we knew he was. He told me that on the phone. I got, well, okay. I check it in my mind, you know. I don't take notes when I'm counseling. I'm glad at 84 I still can remember. But there's nothing worse. You know, I had this affair. Just a minute. What was her name? It's a good way to kill a counselor. So I just make mental notes. Yeah, we'll deal with this on Thursday. We'll deal with this. But see, we're fortunate because it's not like you drag it out over a long period of time. It's intense, 1 week, a good 3 to 4 hours every day. And then we send them on the way with a lot of materials and stuff to help. A lot of the handouts we have. So anything that's on our website, any videos, any handouts, it's all free. People are downloading this stuff all the time. So if there's anything there that someone wrote, it's not all me. Neil Anderson on there. I can't tell you all the people. And I told you I have all the from 1,500 books of prayer stuff on there. With all the counseling books I've read. You know, all the warfare books I've read. And it was really good. I had no idea for a guy that only types like this. There's over 1,000 pages of my typing.
What is your website?
It's Biblical Restoration Ministries. There's a card here. Take a card, any card. Yeah, that's what we have, so you can get our website, Biblical Restoration Ministries. So, Paul, what'd you do with the cards? Wherever.
Okay. And I'll put it up on the screen at the end so you can see it. It is excellent. A ton of resources.
Yeah, for resources, it is free. Why read the book? What the best thing of the book we typed up, you know? And you know where your weaknesses are. I know where my weaknesses are. And I know where I need help, you know? Because of what I haven't been through some of the things I've been through. That kind of thing. Okay, anybody else have any idea? Can you
When you said he was a rapper, was it the music?
No. I never heard of him do the rapping.
Personal trainer, good looks, personal trainer, really good looking, the personal trainer to the wealthy, so some truth that's binding him. I don't know what that is.
You're going, I mean, you're thinking down the right road. See, I was not thinking of the bad stuff. Somehow the bad stuff's been dealt with. And you want to keep going hard. There must be somebody he hasn't forgiven. There must be some curse that we didn't break. Let me tell you, I'll tell you, when I pray to God to do something, I don't pray over and over and over and over. God hears and answers prayers. You know what I mean? I don't have to pray the same thing. Maybe I didn't pray hard. Maybe I didn't pray with sincerity. All of this. Paul told me to tell you about this one guy, and I won't mention his name, but Conway knows him. He comes from back east, the East Coast. He comes out and calls me on the phone so I can pray over him and calm the demons. And he goes to people to pray for him, you know, spends money, and have Neil Anderson pray over him, and pray over him, and Mark Rubin pray over him. I don't know if Warner prayed over him, but his dad may have. But anyway, you see, and I looked at him and I said, you know what? You do not need a power encounter. You need a truth encounter. I mean, how many times do you have to pray over somebody that has a demonic thing? I mean, literally. When you know that they dealt with the bitterness, you know, they dealt with the ground issues. Because remember, it's not the presented problem, it's why. I always look for the ground. That's why my book is Taking Back Surrender Ground. What ground have they given that they're a mess in there? And you see it in Scripture. It's not that I just put it together. I saw it in the Word. If you're a biblical counselor, you ought to be reading the Word. And you'll get insights. Often, in someone's life, as you're reading, something comes up and it just fits that situation. She's on the really the right track. Yes.
Maybe he's struggling because he knows his past
was dark, and that he's changed now, and his future cannot be the same as his past.
You're getting close. You're getting more.
He's fearful of what's not going to happen or what is going to happen.
See, we know the enemy's involved in his life. Why? He doesn't have peace. See, and so the enemy's involved in robbing him. And we think, obviously, it must be, you know, my mind goes to the occult, to be covering everything. You know, did we miss something in bitterness or whatever? Because we have another misconception. The enemy doesn't only work with sin. He works in religion. The enemy can work in religion. Yes. And the enemy, how do I know the difference between if what I want to do, if it's of the Lord or is it of the enemy?
It'd be with prayer and control of the Holy Spirit. If the Holy Spirit, you ask the Holy Spirit to work through you, he'll give you the answers.
Yes. Well, I think the Holy Spirit finally got the answers because my mind was, you know, my mind is being affected by what I knew about. But I wasn't looking at it because I forgot one important thing. Satan works in the religious areas as well as in the dark areas. He's an angel of what? Light. And what was the heart's desire of this guy? To be godly. To be godly. I've never known a Christian that had a desire to be godly like this guy does. I mean, he's reading all these books. He's doing everything he knows, memorizing scriptures, you know, spending 3 hours and sometimes more than that a day in his quiet time with God. But the key is the results are not peace. See, there's something wrong. I mean, there's just something wrong. And I realized that the enemy was driving him. The Lord leads. That's an important truth. Is your counsel being driven? Not to evil, but driven in the other directions. Because there's no benefit. I mean, you're looking at them. I mean, the dentist in our building, I call her Pain because you have to pay her and her husband ache and pain. They work together. They're Catholics, and we have a great time with them. We love them to death. They've been my dentist for 30 years, you know. And I'll say, you're smiling. I'm amazing. You're so down in the mouth all the time. But... she's at church all the time. Every time she gets away to pray the rosary and all this stuff. But you say, yeah, well, she's Catholic. Well, what about if you're not a Catholic? What about people that are being driven and there's no fruit? You don't see anything. Why doesn't he have peace? And you know how I got him? I don't counsel normally. I mean, I'm just not the normal person. I said, you're a personal trainer. I said, when you were here, we had the horrible snowstorms, remember those? Well, he was here. So a lot of his muscles were covered with sweaters and things. And I said, you know, I think you, and he's very nice looking. I said, I think you really got a good physique. And I don't, you know. And I think I would like you to be my personal trainer, yeah? And because I'd like to have a body like yours. And because he knows I'm leading him down a road. Well, he's hit the road, and I said, well, okay, I drink all those power drinks, and I see the guy. I was in the doctor's office, and they had a muscle magazine, and this guy, he had like 16 things across his stomach, you know. And he had this bottle of stuff. So I go in and said, like an old man that doesn't know anything. I said, doctor, tell me, if I drink this, will it look like that?
No.
But, so, I'm in this program, and I'm giving it money, and I've done it for 4 weeks, and I still have flab. I quit. You go. Who is he reading? Godly men at the end of their life. Tozer didn't start out like Tozer at the end. You know what I'm saying? And so why was he discouraged? Because he wasn't there. His goal was what? To hear from God in a very special way. You know, as he read these books and all. And he wasn't reading goofy books. Really good books. I mean, the guy sits down and reads a theology. You know, a book on theology because he's a brand new Christian. Is really searching. And he began to see, and you know, that freedom? That truth freed him. I said, Satan drives, but Jesus leads. The Lord is my what? And what does he do? He leads me by. He doesn't drive me. In that first church, you know, with the cowboys and the loggers. Most of the people up there were cattlemen, but we had one guy in the church that had sheep. He had a band and a half. That's 1,500 sheep plus lambs. And he'd take them down the highway, only one highway through the upper part of California there. Just one highway through, and there's all these sheep. You want to drive sheep, you know what they do? They bunch together, they close together, and they won't walk. You drive cattle, but you lead sheep. So his drivenness to be godly had enemy involvement because he never was satisfied, ever. You know, and so he saw it when, you know, I looked in the mirror and I didn't look like him after a month. You know, all of a sudden he began to what? He began to click. It was his world. But he realized, no, you don't get a beautiful body in a week or 2 weeks or 4 weeks. You have to work at it. So the picture of the guy in the magazine wasn't when he drank that thing yesterday and he was 300 pounds. Now he's got a, you know, 17 pack on his stomach. And so that, I never thought about that. But as soon as he got it, I'll tell you on the phone that darkness was gone. It was gone. And I can think someone's memorizing scripture, reading all the good books, and praying, crying out to God, and all the stuff he does, there should be some joy. Peace. None at all.
So he had to surrender and expectation.
Yeah, to see that he wanted the gold now. See, all of a sudden he realized that in his own, because he'd identify, he knows that you start with a personal trainer, in 2 weeks you may see a difference, a pound on the scale. But, you know, you don't see 3 pounds of muscle. You know, that kind of a thing. And he realized that he's reading these godly men who have walked with God all these years, and he wanted that with all of his heart. He wanted to be like these men. He didn't want to be them, but he wanted to have that same close, intimate time with God. And they're writing at the end of their life, not when they're starting the journey. So, I mean, I hope that helps you, because I really felt terrible. Here I am, not only his ex-counselor, I'm his disciple, and I'm getting nowhere. And, you know, I didn't ask me a thought to suicide. I didn't even want to hear that. I thought, brother, I don't think I could handle that. Oh, brother, what if I led this guy? You know? But I'm thrilled. Now, but what I wanted you to see here, some things that you could miss in counseling. Satan drives, the Lord leads. And you'll find a lot of religious Christians that are driven. And you've got to deal with it carefully. And when you tell me I'm not supposed to pray anymore, or what, you know what I'm saying? Realize that when there's not peace, that's a fruit of the Spirit. And they're doing all the right stuff, and there's no fruit. They're barren. Or judgmental and critical of other people because they don't pray as long. Yes?
Well, when we've done some of the Emmanuel stuff here, you know, we've been dated. To Kate, his metaphor was the Christian life needs to be, you need to be not rowing but sailing. That's what reminds me of what you're saying.
Yeah, that's a good metaphor, yeah. I don't see anything wrong, and I'm sure Tozer didn't, praying to the Holy Spirit. I just finished reading Wayne Grudem's theology book just for an update, updating myself in theology for a while. And, you know, the Holy Spirit and God and the Lord are all one. And they're all involved in prayer. And if you don't feel comfortable in praying to the Holy Spirit to do what the Holy Spirit does, that's fine. Ask the Lord to tell the Holy Spirit to do it. Or something, you know what I'm saying? I just don't have a problem with that. But I did when I went to Biola, because the guy who founded Calvary Bible College, Dr. Walter Wilson, said to pray to the Holy Spirit. He'd do it every time he said in our chapel, and the teachers would all cringe. I don't see anything wrong with that. But pray, you know, pray for discernment. God gave it to me. You know, we don't have all the answers. There's not a counseling book that has all the answers. This has all the answers, I believe. Because the scripture says God has given him everything for life and what?
Godliness.
So if I want to really know how to be godly, I don't have to buy Logan's book. Oh, no, you need to buy my book. No, it's in the book. You understand? It's in the book. This should be your main counseling tool, is this. Okay, I'm going to ask you a question. We got to get to worry. Because I'm worried about not getting to worry. Okay, what does scripture say that I can base sound truth on? Two things. How do I know if I go to your church and hear your pastor, how do I know if he's giving me the straight scoop?
God's word.
No? You're right, but it's something said. These two things. From Timothy. He said, we base sound teachings on the words of Christ and that which leads to Christ likely. Who's the founder of Christianity?
Jesus.
I think it's Jesus. And so if what I'm hearing is contradicting what he said, that's a big flag. And if I do it, and if it's not going to move me towards godliness, that's the other flag. And that's scripture. Scripture says those two things. So in order to know what Jesus said, I read the Gospels continually, all the time. Always. Even though I've read the Gospels through, in that one book, I've read it so many times. I read it this morning before I came. So, I got to know what Jesus said. Or the essence of what he said. I was surprised years ago that in a lot of seminaries, the life of